It is sad.
And who makes that? Who makes that?
God.
Oh, yes. We've been saying about that. So I asked them all if they would sing Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, because God made the stars. And Kai usually loves the microphone, but he said no. He gets too shy today. Lucy said, I'll do it. And Boone didn't really say yes or no, Polly. He just kind of walked off. So Lucy, will you stand up really big and tall for me on this step so everybody can see you? Because she's so tall. And she's going to sing us God Made the Stars, Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up, high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
Thank you so much. All right, guys, you can go on. Do you want them to stay up for the program or just go on down, Drew? All right, just go on down, guys, and we'll see you after church. Thank you, Lucy. You can go on to class now. I tried, Dolly. They wouldn't do it.
That you and I would remember just what it was that they sought to preserve.
If tomorrow all things were gone, a word for one life, as we had the start of you, with just my children and my life, thank my lucky stars to be here today. But the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take my away.
appreciate another opportunity to come and preach what God has laid upon our heart. And I'm glad that everyone's here to support our youth today on Youth Sunday. I'm glad to see y'all have come out to show support for our youth, and they need our support.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I'm thankful for all the people that I have that help me with the youth, because without them, I couldn't do this. Ain't no way I could do it on my own. And I appreciate everyone that puts forth effort to work with our youth.
Right.
Because it's hard for one person to do it all. And I really deeply appreciate that. If you have your Bibles, you'd like to turn with us, we're going to be in the book of Joshua. We're going to be reading some very familiar scripture in Joshua. I'm sure most of you have heard it. But we're going to talk about it in Joshua chapter 24. And in chapter 24 of Joshua is the very last chapter of the book of Joshua. And here, as Joshua has taken over for Moses, Moses has died after leading the nation of Israel for so many years, Joshua picks up where Moses leaves off. And Joshua, as Moses was a very godly man. And he led the nation of Israel all the way through. And here in the last chapter of Joshua, my Bible calls it Joshua's farewell address. And here we're going to read some scripture as Joshua knew his time was coming to an end. But even though he knew his time was coming to an end, he still had a desire for the nation of Israel to follow God. And he was concerned about how they were going to do when he was gone. And it's all about choice today. Today is about choices. Everybody in here has choices in their lives. Every single day, we make a choice about what we're going to do, how we're going to live, how we're going to talk, how we're going to treat other people. Everything that we do in our lives is choices. And there's choices are what define who we are. We have to understand that. And here in the book of Joshua, chapter 24, it says in verse 1, it says, "And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers, and they presented themselves before God." So Joshua here gathers up everybody from the nation of Israel to sit them down to tell them what God has laid on his heart.
Yeah.
And it's very important that we understand that Joshua didn't tell this just a few Israelites. He wanted the whole nation to hear what God had to say.
Amen.
Now we're going to skip on over to verse 14. We're going to read just two verses there. It says, "Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that are on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord."
Amen.
Now, here in Joshua, says in verse 14, I'm going to point out, it says, "Now therefore, fear the Lord." As you've heard Charles point out several times, therefore is, there's a reason behind that. And if you look in verse 13, you'll find the reason. He tells them they need to fear the Lord. Look what he says in verse 13. It says, "And I have given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you built not, and you dwell in them, vineyards of the vineyards and olive yards which ye planted not, do you eat." The Lord had given them the land of Canaan, And it wasn't just something they had to go in and just take it. They had to fight for it. But God provided a way for them to be successful, to get what they had. And Joshua is just reminding them of what they had and why they needed to fear the Lord, because the Lord could take it away.
Yeah.
And we see that happen several times. When they went into captivity, it was because they rebelled against God, and they had chose not to follow in His righteousness and His commandments. We see that He tells them, "Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve Him." There's choices right here that Joshua has pointed out. Fear and serve. Choices that we ourselves need to make.
Yeah.
Our nation is in trouble.
Amen.
Yeah.
Choices are being made every day against God.
Amen.
Every day in this nation, in this community, or all around this church, people are choosing against God.
Yeah. Amen.
And it's all about choices today. Everybody makes choices. You make a choice today whether you're going to follow in the steps of God or you're going to reject what He has to say.
Right.
Choices. Now, we look and it says, "And serve Him in sincerity and in truth." Over in Deuteronomy, Moses wrote this in chapter 10, verse 12. It says, "And now, Israel, what doth the Lord require of thee, but to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all His ways, and to love Him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and His statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good."
Yeah.
For thy good. You know, Moses, we know, wrote the Ten Commandments. And we know the nation of Israel knew what they were. But just because they knew what they were doesn't mean they always followed them. Sometimes they made choices not to follow the Word of God. Just like today. There's people today that know the Word of God, have heard the Word of God, but they choose not to follow.
Right. Amen.
Choices that we can make ourselves. We all can make choices that can hurt our relationship with God. Now, look what he says here right after that. He says, "Put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt. Serve ye the Lord." Put away the gods. Notice that it says gods, not one, but several. And the Bible teaches us that anything becomes between me and God can be an idol.
Sure.
And we notice that there's several times that we can read the nation of Israel had idols, had false gods, had things come up. And today we don't see much of what they did, but it's the same thing, just in a different form.
Right.
Anything that comes between you and God is an idol and can be a god in your life.
Sure.
We see here that he tells them to put away the gods. I also want to point out in Titus chapter 2, verse 7. Look what Paul wrote to Titus. It says, "In all things, showing thyself a pattern of good works and doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, and sincerity." In other words, showing integrity, reverence, and incorruptible. Sound speech that cannot be condemned. That he that is of the contrary. In other words, anybody that is an opponent may not be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. You know, when we read what Paul is writing in Titus and we see what Joshua is telling them here, it says, "Serve him in sincerity and truth and put away the things that are hindering your relationship with God." There are several things in our lives today that can hinder our relationship with God. It can come between us and God. And the devil will use anything he can to stop you from being close to God. He doesn't care what it is, and he doesn't care what it takes. If he can find a way in, he'll get in.
Yep, man.
And he'll use it to all his advantage. And Joshua here had a concern for his nation of Israel and all his people, because he knew that it was time. Because once you read the rest of this chapter, it ain't long that Joshua dies. He dies. And I believe, without a doubt, when he did this, he knew his time was up.
Right.
And he had a concern for his people. And I ask you today, do you have a concern for your people? Do you have a concern like Joshua did for his people? He wanted them to choose to serve God. You notice he says he doesn't force them. He says you have to do it. But he wanted them to choose. That's the thing about God. God will not force you to worship Him.
Right. No.
He will not do that. But He wants you to choose to worship Him.
Right.
That's what He wants. We see here, when it talks about putting away the gods of your fathers who served on the side of the flood, and in Egypt. Well, that tells me when they were in Egypt, the Egyptians had an influence on the nation of Israel.
Yep.
They had false gods. They had several false gods in Egypt. And what that tells me is Joshua's telling them, forget about that stuff. It was in Egypt.
Yeah.
Think about this today in this nation. We were founded upon Christianity in this nation. But now, look at all the evil that's around us and all the idols and the false gods and things that are around us. Do you not think that influences us as a hindrance on Christians today? That's no different than right here. In Egypt, the Egyptians had an influence on the nation of Israel and following after God. Well, Christians today in this country are being influenced by everything around them. And it's the same thing here. We have to be careful about what our choices that we make in our lives.
Amen.
We have to make sure that our choices are what God's will.
Right.
We see here one thing. It says, put away the gods. Number one that I want to point out is idols. That is the biggest thing in this country today is idols. Now, it ain't the golden cow that you see from the Old Testament and some of the other things that they made back then. But it's other things. It can be anything that you enjoy to do and put it between you and God.
Right, man.
If you like to go fishing, that's great. But if you start fishing more than you worship God, and it comes between you and church, it's wrong. It's an idol. Everybody knows I like to hunt, and if I start hunting more than I start following God, and I quit going to church because I'm too busy in the woods, guess what? That's wrong. It's an idol, and I've put it above God, and it's dangerous to make that choice. That's a choice that I would make, and it would be a choice that would be wrong. Look in Joshua 24:23 says, now therefore put away, said he, the strange gods which are among you, and incline your heart unto the Lord God of Israel.
Yeah.
We as a nation today and as people need to understand the dangers of idols becoming between us and God. The choices that we make in our lives.
Yeah.
Very, very important. Another thing I want to point out is evil. That's another thing that is running rampant in this nation. You can turn on the news, and it ain't long you're going to hear something bad is going on. Somebody's getting murdered. Somebody's getting killed. There's shootings everywhere. The devil is on the rampage. We see it every day. But it's choices that are made. The devil can't make you do anything. But he can suggest it.
That's right.
I've had people tell me, well, the devil made me do it. No, the devil can't make you do anything. But he can highly suggest that you do it.
That's right.
You make the choice whether you do it or not. It's all on you. There's no one. You can't go and stand before God and go, well, so-and-so made me do it. It ain't my fault. That ain't going to work.
No.
That ain't going to work. It's your choice. It's choices of our lives that we have to be careful about. There's choices. And there's consequences to those choices.
Yeah.
But look in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16. It says, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings before my eyes. and cease to do evil. That's Isaiah speaking to the nation of Israel and what God is telling them. Now, in 1 Thessalonians 5:22 tells us, abstain from all appearances of evil. We have to watch out for the evil that's around us. It can influence you. It can have an effect on you. It can even make you make choices that you shouldn't do. We have to be careful with that. Another one is a forward mouth. And that's a word you don't hear much anymore, but basically it's deceitful. And if there's a lot of deceit today, there's a lot of it. There's plenty of deceit going around. Amen. Look at what Proverbs 4:24 says. It says, put away from thee a forward mouth. In other words, a deceitful mouth. And perverse lips put far from me. Very important that the choices we make and the things that we say, when we say things we shouldn't say, it's a choice that we made. And it can be very dangerous.
Yeah.
It can be very dangerous. How dangerous can it be? Look over in James chapter 3. Look what James, the half-brother of Jesus, has to say in James chapter 3, verse 6 through 8. It says, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison.
Yes.
The tongue can get you in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
Something that all of us has a choice whether we say something we shouldn't say or not.
Yeah.
How many times have you said something that you wish you wouldn't have said? I'll be the first one to admit that I've said things I wish I wouldn't have said.
Yeah.
And it can hurt people. And it can hurt yourself. It can hurt you. It can hurt yourself more than it can hurt people sometimes.
Right.
Sometimes you can say things that can destroy your witness.
Amen.
Yeah. They can just ruin your reputation.
Absolutely.
And when you do that, you've made a choice that can just destroy everything you stand for.
Mm.
It's very important that the choices we make when we talk can hurt so many people and hurt ourselves so much. Very important that we watch what we say.
Yeah.
Look over in. Another I want to point out is bitterness. Bitterness is something that we choose to do. Bitterness has ruined a lot of Christians. They've had their feelings hurt, and they just give up on church. They've give up on God, and they're just going to stay at home. And then when you do that, the devil's got you right where he wants you. If you'll stay at home and don't do anything, you're not an effective Christian.
Amen.
No. And the devil has won. Bitterness has ruined a lot of people. And that's a choice that you make. You don't have to be that way. You choose that. Look what Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 31 through 32. It says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Very important that we do not allow bitterness in our hearts. Don't choose bitterness. Don't choose that. It can ruin you. It can hurt you. Don't let it happen. Look what he says in verse 15. He goes on to say, and if it seem evil unto you, serve the Lord. Choose you this day whom ye will serve. Notice he didn't talk about choosing later or choosing sometime in the future. He says choose this day. The Bible tells us that today is the day of salvation. We need to make sure that we choose today what we're going to do with God.
Amen.
It says choose whom you'll serve, whether the gods which you've served on the other side of the flood or the gods of the Amorites, which in the land you dwell. So that tells me right at this point in time, they were in the land of the Amorites. Just like in Egypt.
Yeah.
Here you got another people can influence them. Same thing here. The Amorites had somewhat of an influence on the nation of Israel, and they had some of their gods as false gods around them. Very important to stay away from that stuff.
Yeah, man.
As today, as a nation of America, Christianity has become the minority in this country.
Sure, man.
It's no longer the majority of people anymore. So it's very important that us as Christians do not allow all the other things around us to influence us and it become between us and God. I think Joshua had a concern here for his people. The same concern that we should have about the choices that we make. And the last part he says, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
That's
a choice that Joshua had made for his family. We will serve the Lord.
Yeah.
He couldn't make the nation of Israel follow God. He couldn't force them to do it. He told them they had to choose. And that's the same way with God today. He wants you to choose to serve Him.
Yeah.
He's not going to force Himself upon you.
Oh.
It's a choice that me and you make. It's time for us to choose who we're going to serve.
Right.
If we're going to serve God the way God expects, there is requirements. As we read in Deuteronomy chapter 10, it says, and now Israel, what doth the Lord require of thee? But to fear the Lord thy God, walk in all His ways, and to love Him, and to serve the Lord with all thy heart and with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and His statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good.
Yeah.
It's good to make the choice to serve God.
Amen.
It'll be a benefit to you and your family. Joshua had made the decision that his house was going to serve the Lord. He made the choice to serve God. And I'm afraid there's a lot of households today that are not making that choice. They're making the choice to go with what the world wants, what the devil has out there for them. There's a lot of things out there the devil can give you. But don't let that stop you. Don't let that stop you from what God has to offer.
Amen.
Choose God. Make the choice to serve God. Don't let idols, don't let evil, don't let a deceitful mouth, and don't let bitterness stop you from choosing what God has for you and to serve Him with all your heart, with all your soul. As Chloe comes and gets a song,
I'm standing in for Chloe, I guess.
As they come get a song, I want to ask you, have you made the choice to serve God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind? Have you made that choice? Have you made the choice for your family's sake to serve the Lord?
Right. Amen.
We have to make that choice. As for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. That's a choice we all should be making.
Yes.
We need to understand the importance of serving God and making that choice. Everybody in here makes choices every single day. And I guarantee almost every choice you make has an influence on your relationship with God.
Absolutely.
Everything we do in our lives. Think about the choices that you make every day. Is this something that's going to influence my relationship with God? Is it something that's going to hinder me from being the Christian I should be?
Yeah.
Is it something that's going to tear me down?
Yeah.
And not be the effective Christian that God would expect? Think about the choices that we have in our lives every single day. It's full of them. And the devil's always going to be there to do his best to make you make the wrong choice.
Amen.
Don't let him in. Don't let him do it.
That's right. Yes.
If everyone will please stand and turn to page 375, it will be the first, second, and last verse.
I was thinking, as Drew did such a wonderful job of distinguishing the difference between choice and consequence, because with every choice, there's a consequence. Had you ever thought about that if God had not have given Adam that liberty, what you would be this morning? A robot. You wouldn't have any choice. He would have pre-programmed you before you came to life. That's the way it had been. But he said, no, I will not create man that way. I will create man with the ability to choose. Yes. And you go to hell because you want to go to hell.
That's right.
You go to heaven because you want to go to heaven.
That's right.
A choice. Great job. Great job. Appreciate the scriptures. And Joshua said, as for me and my house, I can say that today. As for me and my house, I want to serve the Lord. And I would do it again. Amen.
Amen.
I know I can't get saved again. I understand that. We're saved one time, that's it. But if I had the choice, I'd say, I'll do it again. I would do it again. I wouldn't trade my life for nothing. This is our sanctuary. We come in here, we separate ourselves from that world out there. This is a safe place, right? You can go by the fire department, call it a safe place for the kids' stuff. This is a safe place for us to come in and to worship. But it's good to be here this morning. We appreciate the youth. Drew and the youth workers and the youth. I never will get these sticks, these things. I had a church in next to Hickory, and the Hickory Crawdads was a semi-pro baseball team down there in Hickory that some of my youth went down there, and somehow or another, I don't know how they found out about it, but they would take different songs and they would take these sticks and pantomime that, and they got them to come to the ball field and perform down there and put it on television. Ain't that amazing? And that's a witness for the Lord. And so thank God for the youth and what they do, and though you workers, you work with them, and I appreciate it. And let me say this too, I want to emphasize Bible drill team. I've had state winners on Bible drill teams in North Carolina. Let me tell you, that is a wonderful thing. And so when you start, and I think this is what we're beginning to see now, we need to work with these little ones while they're little. Work with them, teach them Bible drill. And then as they grow up, they'll know what commitment means. And you instill in those little ones commitment to God and to the church and put it first, then you'll build some tremendous youth. But it starts with the little ones. Starts with the little ones. We need some teachers. We need some coaches on this Bible drill. Some of you can do that. And let me tell you, it's amazing to see a child stand up here and quote the scripture. It's amazing. If you've ever been to one of them Bible drills, I sat there amazed at how they knew the scriptures. And some of you need to say, Susan, I will be a coach. I will to be a part of that, to work involved in these kids, because you're building their lives, eternal things. So let me encourage you to do that. This is a wonderful thing. I want to see that happen one day that our children can stand on this stage and just say Bible drill and quote them scriptures right on, find it in the Word of God. It'll be wonderful, okay? All right, that's my commercial for now. But I love you. God bless you. We're glad you're here. If you're visiting with us, we're glad you're here. And I always enjoy the youth. They always come up with something fantastic, and I really enjoy it. Now, so don't forget tonight, the Russell family will be singing for us tonight. This is our fifth Sunday, and they'll be singing, so you come and be a part of that. We'll worship in song.
No choir practice.
No choir practice. But also, I need to meet with the Church Constitution Bylaws Committee at 5 o'clock in my study here, so don't forget that. And the trustees meeting, I believe, is at 5 o'clock. So don't forget that today. Are you glad you're saved?
Amen.
Amen. You're glad you're going to heaven?
Amen.
Do you believe in it?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
All right. It's wonderful to believe. Say, well, you've never seen it, right? Have you ever seen the wind? No. Have you ever seen the effects of it? So you know it's real, right? But it's real, but you didn't see it, right? You can't see God, but you can feel the effects of it in your heart, right? Same thing. So, thank God for His presence on this planet through the power of the Holy Spirit within us. Have a wonderful afternoon. And so, at this time, I guess we're going to beat the Methodist to the restaurant. All right. Thank you for coming. Now, let me say this. I'm going to be at the back. I see we got the deacons back there, but they'll shake hands with you, and I'll get you first, and then they can get you as you go on out. So it's a good welcome committee. God bless you, and have a wonderful, wonderful day in the Lord.